Peter, defense spending was in focus when the federal budget was recently tabled. $8 billion was earmarked over the course of 5 years. Curious to get your thoughts on how they arrived at that number, and is that enough given the current landscape?
Well, in a word, no, it's not enough to get us to the elusive 2% of GDP, which there had been sort of hints and some allusion to the fact that we were going to see dramatic increases and moving closer to that. It's really below $8 billion that has been committed in this budget, which would only get us to 1.5% of GDP. We're currently sitting at just below 1.4, around 1.36. And, you know, those are a lot of numbers and fractions, but the truth of the matter is Canada finds itself really near the bottom of the 30 member NATO countries when it comes to spending with that calculus of GDP. And there is, even within that envelope, Larysa, some creative calculus, things like pensions, some of the spending that previously hadn't been counted towards the NATO 2%. And so I think there has been generally a feeling of disappointment that with the pressure brought to bear by what's unfolding in Ukraine, a general sense within the Canadian Armed Forces that they haven't been getting sufficient money. And this money as well, I need to point out, is basically earmarked over a 5, 6, 7 year spending envelope. And very often that money doesn't get spent within the annual budget and therefore lapses and goes back to the fiscal framework.
Help us understand why is that? Well, why are we having a difficult time hitting that 2% target that NATO is asking? And what does that number amount look like for Canada?
So that's a great question. Very often the money is most associated with procurement, although obviously it's salaries, it's infrastructure, it's deployments, it's things like fuel and maintenance and all of the investments that go into a big Department of National Defense, both civilian and uniform side. But really where the difficulty arises is when you see these protracted procurements, to coin a phrase, things that you can't buy off the shelf. Fighter aircraft is an obvious example. And there was news about finally a commitment to buy 88 F-35s, something a previous government had committed to. I was a part of that government. Over a decade ago. And so that commitment was made, but that money won't be spent immediately. Same with the procurement and the building of surface combatants, our replacement of the Royal Canadian Navy fleet. That is going to take, 8, 10, 12, 15 years. And so an influx of money right away won't count towards the GDP 2% because it won't be spent for some time, a decade or more. And therefore, it makes it increasingly difficult to be able to say with honesty that we are spending that amount, 2% of GDP, because we're not. We're earmarking it for the future as opposed to actually investing it today.
Part of that $8 billion equation is $500 million in military aid to Ukraine, in addition to $1 billion in loans to Ukraine. And of course, the Prime Minister recently announced an additional $100 million over the weekend. Your thoughts on Canada's response to Russia's war on Ukraine?
Sort of medium, lukewarm compared to other countries. It has been coming over a period of time. So we've seen a steady increase initially with loans, initially with some lethal aid, but before that it was things like vests and helmets and more defensive type equipment. But we have seen Canada and other countries ratchet up along with sanctions, along with other efforts to assist with displaced people, immigration. But what the Ukrainians and what President Zelensky have been calling for most, as we know, is lethal weapons. And, short of a closing of the airspace, the use of fighter aircraft, artillery, to bring down Russian helicopters and Russian aircraft that are dropping ordnances, dropping bombs on Ukrainian cities, degrading their infrastructure, killing people, tens of thousands of people. And so that's what they've been calling for. Things like Javelin missiles for armor piercing, Stinger missiles, so surface to air. The British have provided a Star Streak type of upgraded missile. So those are the things that they need most and what the president has been calling for. Canada hasn't really stepped up to a large degree in that space. They have provided some. I note that recently Germany and others are now providing main battle tanks to be able to take the fight to the Russians and defend some of their cities, most notably the capital of Kyiv. But in the Donbass region, in border regions in the east, where the Russians have exerted some control, this is where the fight is going to be focused in the coming days. And that's where they need more heavy armor, armored cars, missiles, the ability to really defend and in some cases retake some of the lost territory. Canada hasn't figured prominently in that effort.
Canada's finance minister, Chrystia Freeland, recently quoted as saying that Russia's President Vladimir Putin is a threat to Canada's national security and security of the world. Agreed?
Agreed. And many people have been saying this and taking note of this for a long time, back, basically going back, Larysa, to 2014, when Russia similarly crossed the border of Ukraine and annexed Crimea, an entire region of that country. This is part of, I think, this very diabolical, megalomaniac plan that Vladimir Putin has to reassemble the Soviet Union. But closer to home, let's never forget that within the Arctic and across the Arctic Ocean, the Russians are our neighbors. And geographically, they are in proximity to Canadian waters and coming closer to the Arctic and the territories, important Canadian resources, including undersea resources. We have insufficient sovereignty protection in place. Our northern warning system is antiquated. We have insufficient and outdated aircraft. The Russians on the other side of the Arctic Ocean are refurbishing many of their former air bases. They're putting new infrastructure in place, landing strips and deep water refueling ports. And so this has to be a real concern for Canada. We are, through NORAD, of course, bound to protect the Arctic approaches, both air and marine. But we have to do more in terms of investment, in terms of our commitment to working with the Americans to protect North America, but particularly from that vulnerable place of the Arctic.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky has been vocal and critical of the former leaders of Germany and France, Angela Merkel and Nicolas Sarkozy, for blocking Ukraine's entry into the NATO alliance. I'm going to take you back to a 2008 summit, Peter, when you were on that file as the defense minister. Tell us what happened there.
Well, Larysa, it is a rather dark and it was a foreboding time. I was at the conference in Bucharest in 2008 that you mentioned. And one of the items of consideration before NATO at that point was certain countries who had expressed an aspiration to join the alliance. It included Ukraine, but also Georgia, who were similarly under threat from Russia at that time. And there were other countries that, in fact, have since joined NATO and were granted this process called Membership Action Plan. And I remember it well. There was a moment in time where in the program, there was a break. President Sarkozy and Chancellor Angela Merkel had a very intense conversation sort of on the margins of the actual conference. I can picture them over in the corner of the room. It was a very animated discussion. And then quite soon after, the meeting resumed and the discussion turned to Georgia and Ukraine. And both leaders spoke against, for various reasons, including corruption and governance problems in both, that in their opinion should prevent their ascendancy to join NATO. That, of course, set in play a lot of other, let's call them unintended consequences, but it clearly demonstrated that the aspirations of Ukraine were dampened. I think it was a demoralizing blow to them. Similarly, when they were refused their aspirations to join the European Union. And it put Ukraine back in a spot where Russia could continue to exert its influence, including, you know, political interference, cyber attacks. You asked earlier about Russia's actions against the entire Western world. They've been prolific in their cyber attacks on countries in the Baltics, for example, and our own country, others. And so there has been a continuing rolling example of Russian aggression, both on the continent, but in terms of their own actions to try to destabilize others in the West. They have a military that is now, of course, being exposed for some of its weaknesses, but they have nuclear weapons. They have submarines, they have aircraft. They work very closely with other countries, including China. And so there's a lot to be concerned about. That the geopolitical base that we thought was quite stable in Europe has been shaken to its foundation. And there is still much more to come and much more unpredictability when you're dealing with an unhinged leader such as Vladimir Putin, who is increasingly looking cornered and perhaps angry, lashing out, a lot of instability with inside Russia too, which is hard to garner and factor into these equations.
How does Ukraine fit into that equation of NATO application now?
Well, Ukraine is on the front line. So what happens next, of course, has major implications for Europe and for NATO. Some of the other surrounding border countries, including Poland, who have taken many of the refugees, but Czech Republic, Slovak, Moldova, all of these countries really are the proverbial Maginot line, the red line that if it's crossed by Russian troops, this will trigger Article 5, which will bring the entire 30-member NATO alliance into conflict with Russia, which is why the discussion around having protection over the airspace of Ukraine has been so contentious. It's why there is such hesitation, because a direct intercept of Russian jets by NATO jets could trigger a further escalation and a possible World War III. But, you know, your question, where do we sort of stop Russian aggression? In my opinion, it has to be in Ukraine. Because if we're not fighting them in Ukraine, and really it's the Ukrainians who are fighting with the assistance of the alliance and equipment and training, and Canada can be proud of the training that took place between 2014 and onwards that has contributed to the tenacity and the valor that we have seen coming from Ukrainian forces in severely bloodying and causing casualties on the Russian side of this battle. But you know, there is still the very real possibility that conflict could escalate if the Russians are successful in rolling over Ukraine. And this is the fight of their lives. It is the quintessential threat to global security, what's happening inside Ukraine today.
And lastly, before we let you go, Finland and Sweden have suggested that they may join that NATO alliance. Your thoughts on this?
Well, it all ties together nicely, Larysa. Finland should be allowed in as soon as possible. I would say the same of Sweden. And there are other countries who similarly have expressed desires to join the alliance because of that collective security, because of the umbrella that is in a proverbial way extended to member countries. And so, you know, God forbid that we see what's happening in Ukraine break out in Finland or in some of the other aspirant countries. And so let's not repeat the mistakes of Bucharest in 2008. Let's move quickly to get those two countries in, Sweden and Finland. Let's continue to give the Ukrainians as much equipment, lethal support as possible to allow them to wage war to protect their own citizens and push back the Russian aggression. It's become very much a repeated phrase by President Zelensky and others, but this is not just Ukraine's fight. This is the fight of the Western world. And we also have still looming, not that far in the distance, the type of aggression that we have seen coming from China, whether it's against its neighbors on their borders in the South China Sea, building contested islands and waters near some of their other neighboring countries, building icebreakers, building aircraft carriers. This is an extremely volatile and unstable period in world history. And Canada has the capacity to do more, and quite frankly, should do more.